Okay. I think we'll get started. Dana, is that all right? Okay. Great. I want to thank you guys all for coming and spending your Monday evening with me. What I'd like to talk to you, my name is Sanjay Kedhar. I'm one of the faculty members here at UC Irvine. It's nice to see. I see several familiar faces in the audience. What I'd like to discuss today, one of my specialties is inflammatory diseases of the eye. And so what I wanted to discuss with you today was how inflammation in your body can affect the eye. And what we'll talk about today, I think the most important points that we're going to discuss today are one, to realize that the eye can be involved in a lot of so-called rheumatic diseases. So these are diseases that might affect your joints. You think of rheumatoid arthritis or lupus. And in the same way that they may affect your joints or other organs in your body, they can affect your eyes as well. You should also remember that inflammation in the eye can be independent of control of your systemic disease. So there are some people for whom they have rheumatoid arthritis, they're taking other medications, their joints seem to be under good control, but the eye can still become inflamed. So just because the rest of the body seems to be under control, the eye can still become independently inflamed from the same disease. Conversely, sometimes the eye inflammation can mean that the rest of your disease is not as well controlled as we think it is. So, you know, I've seen patients who have rheumatoid arthritis and they come to me and they have an eye problem, an eye inflammation. And in those patients, I call the rheumatologist and tell them, hey, the eye is inflamed. I don't think the disease is as well controlled. The rheumatologist says, no, the joints are fine. Everything else seems to be okay. But what we found when we've looked at these patients over time is that if they do have inflammation in the eye, they have a greater risk for serious complications or even death after 5 to 10 years if we don't do something about the medication, if we don't change their systemic medication. So what we're seeing is that the eyes may be sort of the canary in the coal mine. They may be telling us that the disease is not as well controlled as we think it is. Lastly, if a patient has any kind of rheumatic disease or any inflammatory disease in their body that can potentially affect the eye, and they develop redness, pain, or a change in vision, that needs to be evaluated by an ophthalmologist. It's not something to be evaluated in the urgent care or by the emergency room doctor. Oftentimes, they have little to no training to know what to look for, and these diseases can be serious, both they can be life-threatening, vision-threatening, and eye-threatening. All right, so I thought I'd offer you a little bit of a roadmap of where the talk will go. I'm going to spend a little bit of time on anatomy. How many people here have a medical background or a science background or are familiar with the anatomy? So I'm going to spend a little bit of time showing you guys some pictures of the anatomy, discussing it, so that we have a better understanding of what we're going to talk about for the rest of the discussion. I'm also going to spend some time talking about the various inflammatory conditions of the eye, specific diseases and their effect on the eye, and also treatment and some of the complications. So this is a picture far away from New York City, which is where I moved to Irvine from just a few years ago. So this always reminds me of home. I'm glad not to have the gridlock we had there, although it's not that much better here. So this is general anatomy of the eye. Okay. So the two analogies that I can make are, one, the eye is like a camera. All right. Many of you may have heard this from your ophthalmologist or your optometrist, but basically, and it's like an old camera with film, not the new camera, not the new digital cameras, but we have a lens in the front. So this is the lens. This is typically, this is a cutaway view of the eye. So if you slice the eye in half and you're looking at it from its side, what we see here is this is the front of the eye, sort of like the lens. This is the cornea here. And behind it, this is the lens. This is what becomes a cataract over time. In the back, we have the retina. So this is sort of like the film in a camera. Okay. And then behind that, we have the optic nerve that carries all the images from the retina back to the brain. As you move from front to back, as you get further back, the further back you have inflammation or damage, the more permanent it is. These tissues don't regenerate. They don't, and we can't replace them that easily. So that's why macular degeneration, which occurs in the macula, in the retina, can be such a devastating disease. That's why glaucoma, which affects the optic nerve, can be a devastating disease. Those tissues don't regenerate. We're better off trying to address it, prevent those problems. If you have a cornea problem, we can replace that, cornea transplant. If you have a cataract, we can take that out. So again, the eye's like a camera. We want to avoid damage to the film. The tissues in the front, we'd like to avoid damage to as well, but we can replace those. The second analogy I want to make with the eye is it's like an onion. So there's multiple different layers. There's a retinal layer on the inside. There's something called the choroid, which has a lot of, which is this sort of orange red layer here that has blood vessels in it. And then the outer layer is this white tissue here, which is more like fibrous. It's sort of a harder protective shell to the eye. We think of the eye as being soft and very fragile, but this tissue is actually pretty strong. So as we go through and we talk about inflammations of the eye, I'll point out which part of the anatomy, and I'll keep referring back to this diagram, but I'll show you which part of the anatomy is affected in each of these conditions. So inflammation can affect the eye in a number of ways. This is a sort of a list of, it's a word salad for many of you, but the one thing to think about is anytime you put itis behind a body part, it means inflammation of that body part, okay? So appendicitis, inflammation of your appendix. Scleritis is inflammation of the sclera, that's the outer white part of the eye. Keratitis, kera means cornea. Retinal vasculitis, vasc is vessel, so inflammation of the blood vessels in the retina. And we'll go over these individually. So let's talk about scleritis. So as I said before, we have a white fibrous tissue on the outside of the eye called the sclera, and that can be affected by inflammation in many of these diseases that affect the rest of your body. Things like rheumatoid arthritis and lupus can also affect the white part of the eye, the sclera. So the question is, well, why would something that affects your joints affect your eye? Well, the interesting thing is, the sclera is made of the same material, in fact, the same type of collagen as your joints. So to your immune system, it doesn't know the difference. It's just another joint. The other thing is that when we look, this is a patient of mine from many years back in Baltimore, but she had rheumatoid arthritis and inflammation of the white wall of the eye. So you can see that the eye is red, there's inflammation there, and she was in a lot of pain. The other thing that predisposes the sclera or the wall of the eye to inflammation is it has a very unique blood supply. So most of the time we think about the blood supply as blood comes in through the arteries and it leaves out through the veins. So we think of it as sort of a regular, almost like a river, like a regular flow of blood. The blood supply in the sclera is a little bit different. And what ends up happening is the blood sort of circulates down into the eye, but it oscillates a little bit. It doesn't flow completely through. So what happens is it's almost like standing water and you get buildup of sediments. So you get buildup of proteins and things that cause inflammation. They settle down in that tissue and then promotes inflammation directly there. So that's another reason why we get inflammation in the sclera. Episcleritis, so we think of epidermis, is the most superficial part of your skin. Episcleritis is the most superficial part of your sclera. So the episcleritis can cause a red eye, and we can see that quite often in other patients who have don't have inflammatory diseases. So you can see it in patients who have allergies, people who have dry eye, contact lens wear. Anything environmental can cause this redness in the eye. And oftentimes people just say, you might remark to the person that has this, oh, your eye looks a little red, or is everything okay? And they might not even have noticed because they don't have pain, they don't have irritation, it doesn't cause a change in vision. And typically it goes away by itself. So it's not something that needs to be treated. It'll get better on its own. Sometimes we ask patients just to use iced artificial tears. So artificial tears out of the refrigerator. And that cooling artificial tear and lubricating drop actually will help this to get better. But if it does need treatment, eye drops are usually sufficient. We can give patients steroid eye drops or anti-inflammatory eye drops similar to ibuprofen, and that will get better. Scleritis is the deeper layer of the outside of the eye. And so I don't know if it's as appreciable on the projector as it is on my computer screen, But you can appreciate back from episcleritis, if I go back to this photo here, you know, it's a little bit more white-yellow, and you can see the red blood vessels here. If we go to scleritis, we tend to see this looks a little bit more pink, maybe a little bit more purple if I give you enough suggestion to think that it's there. But we call it a violaceous hue. So patients with scleritis, it's going to look a little bit more purple, pink. And most of the time, these patients are going to complain about a deep, boring pain. It's a headache. It's really unbearable. It'll wake you up from sleep. This is the more serious condition. This can threaten your vision, okay? And this can be also require systemic treatment. Almost all of these patients will need to be taking pills, like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, so things like ibuprofen, Aleve, Advil, or they need to take steroids to help this to get better. There are some times when we can use drops or injections, but it's pretty rare. Most of the time, people will be on pills for this. And in about 45% of these patients that have this disease, they have something going on systemically. Most of the time, those patients, they'll walk in the door and tell you, I have rheumatoid arthritis and my eye hurts and it's red. But there's a small percentage of patients for whom this is the first manifestation of their disease. So they're going to walk in, we see this, and the ophthalmologist will do some blood work, chest x-ray, check the urine, and they'll pick up a disease that was undetermined previously. There are various types of scleritis. The previous photo that I showed you was something called anterior scleritis. So we think of positioning, anterior is front. This type of scleritis is called necrotizing scleritis. This is bad. And what you'll notice here, when you look different from the photos that I showed you just a minute ago, you see this white patch here. And the other thing you notice is that there are no blood vessels, right? There are blood vessels around it, but not in here. So what's happening here? The inflammation is so bad that it's eating away at the wall of the eye. It's destroyed all the blood vessels in this area. And if this inflammation goes unchecked, untreated, it will eat its way through the eye. You'll get a hole in the eye, you'll lose the eye. Sometimes after this is treated, you can see, if you remember I made an analogy of the eye as an onion, there are different layers. What you're seeing here is as all this inflammation clears, you'll sometimes get a thinning of the white part of the eye. And what you're seeing underneath this is this gray-brown tissue called the uvea. So that's the next layer down. And that tissue is very delicate, very thin, and you don't want to really be seeing this because it makes the eye vulnerable to rupture or injury. This is something called scleromalacia perforans, which happens uniquely, mostly, in rheumatoid arthritis patients. They'll start to get, without pain, without significant redness, they'll just start to get thinning of the wall of the eye. And again, if their disease is not treated, if we don't give them anti-inflammatory medications, they will get rupture of the eye and vision loss. So this is a very serious condition. Any patient that has this needs to be treated emergently in order to save their vision. In the past, as I was discussing before, there are certain times when this inflammation of the eye can be associated with a poorer prognosis, meaning the patient may not do as well systemically because we're seeing a signal manifesting in the eye. And necrotizing scleritis is one of those. In the past, we typically would see that patients would die earlier when they developed this. Any patient that developed this would pass away earlier than the other patients who also had the same disease and did not have this. But since since this was in the older literature, and in modern times we have a lot of other different types of drugs that we can treat patients with, which are very successful in keeping these patients alive and healthy for a lot longer time. So this goes back to that patient I showed you, my patient from Baltimore, who had rheumatoid arthritis. One of the things you see here, this is sort of how the eye looked to us, and this is a more magnified view, is you can see these black spots here. These are actually sutures. So these are stitches. In ophthalmology, we operate with sutures that are about a tenth the width of a human hair, and we're tying them off. So what you're seeing here, that's a whole thread. My wife tried to tell me that because I could suture that, I could stitch all the clothes at home and do all the repairs. And I'd have to tell her there's no way. And she certainly didn't want it to look anything like this. So, but the point I wanted to bring up here was that this was a patient was sent to me where the ophthalmologist who was treating her said, well, I'm seeing that the eye's melting, I'm just gonna put a patch over it. So they kept putting different types of tissue and suturing different types of tissue, and every time they'd put a new tissue over it, that would melt. The patient's own immune system would digest that piece of tissue and it would go away. And so what the patient ultimately needed was anti-inflammatory therapy. So again, the patient has these kind of conditions. What they need is that their systemic therapy needs to be changed in order to treat this, as well as to preserve their life. So let's move on a little bit outside the eye. So this is something called orbitopathy, okay? This is a cutaway diagrammatic view of the skull, and we can see that this is the optic nerve that I discussed before, the globe here, the eye. Around the eye, we have muscles, these here, which anchor. So you remember that if you want to look right, there's a muscle that pulls it to the right. Look left, muscle pulls it to the left. Up, down, there's muscles that rotate it. All of them are attached to the outside of the eye and then anchored to the skull. In this area, the whole area is called the orbit. The orbit can also get inflamed. And when that happens, patients can have other different types of symptoms. So they can still get pain, redness, discomfort, but they can get double vision. So why would someone get double vision? Well, if you have a lot of inflammation and the muscle can't work properly, one eye is going to be looking in one direction and the other eye can't pull in the same direction. So you're getting two images from the eyes and you'll get double vision. Patients might get eye bulging or proptosis. There's a number of times when I have patients come in and they say, you know, doc, one eye is smaller than the other, right? Well, oftentimes it's not because one eye is actually smaller than the other, but one eyelid is either drawn up, so you can imagine if the eye is pushed forward, the eyelids will part a little bit more, or if the eye is sunken further in the eye, the eyelids might shrink a little bit. So there's a difference in what we call the interpalpebral fissure, so the space between the upper and the lower eyelid here versus here. And that's because this eyeball is pushing forward towards you, and it's parting those eyelids. Patients will get pain and swelling, and ultimately they can get vision loss. So again, what happens is that they get a lot of inflammation. This, you know, your skull is not going to expand. So you imagine you start putting a lot of inflammation, and there's a lot of flare in that confined space. It's going to wrap around the optic nerve and start compressing it, right? And so if you remember what I said before, when you start compressing the optic nerve, it's nervous tissue, and patients will start to lose vision that way. So orbitopathy is also an emergency. If we go back to our diagram, we were talking about various tissues that could be affected by inflammation. The optic nerve is one of those. And so that's something called optic neuritis. You can